SpaceX has made significant strides in its latest space endeavors, completing the static fire testing of Starship-28 and Super Heavy Booster-10, inching closer to their highly anticipated third orbital flight test. Additionally, a pivotal test of the Starship Lunar Lander Elevator prototype has recently taken place. Most notably, Elon Musk has divulged intriguing insights into the future of Starship and SpaceX's ambitious Mars colonization aspirations. Join us as we delve into these latest updates. As part of preparing the vehicle for flight, SpaceX conducted a full-duration six-engine static fire test of Starship 28 on December 20. Usually, a full-duration six-engine static fire is the final pre-launch test for a Starship. Therefore, it was thought at that time that SpaceX had completed the Ship 28 tests and the vehicle was ready for launch. But on Friday, December 29, SpaceX resumed Ship 28 testing, signaling they needed more tests to confirm Ship 28's readiness. Propellant loading into the ship began during the morning hours of December 29. After the required amount of propellant was loaded, Ship 28 ignited one of its center sea-level Raptor engines for nearly 5 seconds. The test was conducted to demonstrate a flight-like startup for an in-space engine burn. SpaceX attempted to conduct the static fire testing for Booster 10 more than a week ago. However, their two back-to-back attempts were aborted even before loading propellant into the booster at the required level. Typically, during an aborted test or launch, the propellants are returned to storage tanks at the tank farm. But on December 21, all the liquid oxygen was vented out, indicating a deviation from the norm. Clearly, something went wrong that prevented the recovery of liquid oxygen from being performed as usual. There is a decent chance that it has something to do with the recent upgrades made to the heat exchangers, pumps, valves, and plumbing on the oxygen side of the tank farm. The liquid oxygen delivery pipe leading to the launch mount might have also had issues. Teams spent the next few days fixing issues with the tank farm and launch mount. The pipes, valves, and liquid oxygen pumps were purged on December 27 to ensure everything was operating as it should and to ensure the uninterrupted flow of propellant. Huge venting was observed from the launch mount for several minutes, indicating that the liquid oxygen delivery pipes were also purged that day. Scaffolding was erected on the launch mount, enabling workers to work inside the oxygen tank of the booster. After confirming everything was working fine and all the issues were fixed, teams began preparation for Booster 10's static fire testing. Following Ship 28's static fire test on December 29, SpaceX began loading propellants into Booster 10 for engine testing. The liquid oxygen loading was quicker compared to the previous tests, thanks to the newly installed pumps at the tank farm. Engine chill began after the propellants were loaded to the required amount. The water deluge system was activated next, followed by the ignition of all 33 Raptors of the booster for roughly 10 seconds. SpaceX later confirmed that all 33 engines of the booster fired for the full duration of the test. The deluge system performed as designed, and the launch pad remained undamaged after the testing. With the completion of two Starship static fire tests and the 33-engine static fire of the booster, I think it's now safe to say that Ship 28 and Booster 10 have completed all pre-launch tests. However, if SpaceX determines that it is not time to wrap up the pre-launch test campaign, there will be more tests in the coming days. The next milestone is stacking Ship 28 atop Booster 10 for the launch. As per Starbase General Manager Catherine Leaders, SpaceX is targeting the first quarter of 2024 for Starship's third integrated flight test. However, the company still needs to obtain a launch license from the Federal Aviation Administration, which is currently investigating the cause of the November mishap. The FAA will issue a permit once it is satisfied that SpaceX has taken the necessary corrective actions to ensure safety and compliance. Super Heavy Booster 12 was transported to SpaceX's Massey's test site early Friday morning. The booster will soon be subjected to cryogenic proof testing on a thrust simulator stand at Massey's. Several hydraulic rams installed on the test stand will exert force on the aft section of the booster during the test to simulate the force of Raptor engines. Starship 30, which is expected to launch with Booster 12 in the fifth integrated flight test, was also moved to the Massey test site lately. The ship will be subjected to cryo-proof tests on a Starship thrust simulator stand at Massey's in the coming days. The ship thrust simulator stand also has pistons to mimic the force of the Raptor engines during cryo tests. Apart from ensuring the reliability of the plumbing, these types of cryo-proof tests provide engineers with the valuable data they need to determine whether a rocket can endure various kinds of stresses during flight. After cryo-proof tests, the booster and the ship will receive their Raptor engines ahead of static fire testing. A Starship launch tower section and two horizontal storage tanks that left Kennedy Space Center on December 18 arrived at Port of Brownsville on December 29. Plans to build a second launch tower at Starbase have been in the works for the past 3 years. Per the 2020 Starbase launch site expansion plan, the new tower will be located close to the current launch tower. Large steel sections and several metal pieces that resemble the launch tower's columns and beams were delivered to the production site in November. SpaceX completed 7 prefabricated launch tower sections at its Roberts Road facility at Kennedy Space Center several months ago. The tower section shipped to Starbase was one of them. A Starship launch tower is constructed out of 9 prefabricated sections. Based on the latest developments, it looks like SpaceX is planning to prefabricate 2 of the tower sections at Starbase, and they will join the 7 sections from Kennedy to complete Tower 2. A new horizontal storage tank was delivered to the launch site on Thursday, December 28. The tank was later positioned in between the already installed storage tanks. SpaceX is currently undertaking a significant launch site upgrade. They are focused on replacing the vertical storage tanks at the tank farm with horizontal ones. The vertical tanks, installed in 2021, currently store liquid oxygen, liquid nitrogen, and water required for Starship tests and launch operations. After the vertical tanks sustained damage during the first integrated flight test, SpaceX decided to replace them with horizontal ones. The already active horizontal methane tanks and the newly installed tanks will store propellants for future Starship launches. It's currently unclear when the new tanks will be operational. Elon Musk recently shared information about Starship reusability and SpaceX's Mars colonization plans. He said that the Super Heavy booster can be used more frequently than the Starship, as it returns to the launch site in about 6 minutes after launch and can theoretically be ready for reflight in an hour. Meanwhile, Starship reuse is limited to once every 24 hours, since the spacecraft must make at least one orbit around the Earth before returning to the launch site. This means ship production needs to be roughly an order of magnitude higher than booster production. And to achieve Mars colonization in roughly 3 decades, ship production should reach 100 to 300 per year. This insight underscores the meticulous planning and scaling necessary to realize the ambitious goal of Mars colonization within approximately 3 decades, emphasizing the pivotal role of high-rate ship production in this monumental endeavor. A mock-up of SpaceX's elevator concept for the Starship lunar lander was recently tested by NASA astronauts Nicole Mann and Douglas Wheelock. The elevator will be used to transport equipment and crew from the Starship lander to the lunar surface during the Artemis 3 lunar mission, which will bring humans back to the surface of the moon as early as 2025. The mock-up elevator has a full-scale basket section with functioning mechanical assemblies and crew interfaces that were subjected to testing. Mann and Wheelock performed tests of the elevator controls and operations as the basket moved along a vertical rail system. Astronauts performed the test while wearing spacesuits to simulate the constraints of moving and working in the lunar environment. According to NASA, the test allowed the astronauts to interact with a flight-like design of the elevator system, serving as both a functional demonstration of the hardware and providing the chance to receive valuable feedback from a crew perspective. Now, let's discuss some of the latest updates from the world of science and technology. SpaceX successfully launched a U.S. military spaceplane on board its Falcon Heavy rocket the past week. A Falcon Heavy rocket lifted off from NASA's Kennedy Space Center on Thursday, December 28, carrying the U.S. Space Force's X-37B spaceplane to orbit. 2.5 minutes after liftoff, the rocket's 2 side boosters separated from the center core and flew back to Earth. The boosters performed safe touchdowns at Cape Canaveral Space Force Station's landing zones 1 and 2, marking a SpaceX booster's 257th and 258th landings. About 4 minutes into the flight, the second stage separated from the core stage and continued its journey toward space. The center core was expended and splashed into the Atlantic Ocean. SpaceX ended its webcast before X-37B was deployed in its final orbit, at the request of the U.S. Space Force. The X-37B is an autonomous reusable vehicle that looks like NASA's retired space shuttle, but is much smaller. The spaceplane is 8.8 meters long, with a wingspan of 4.6 meters. In comparison, the space shuttle measured 37 meters in length and more than 24 meters in width. X-37B is the smallest and lightest orbital spaceplane flown to date. The 5,000-kilogram spaceplane is powered by a single Aerojet AR-2 engine that provides a thrust of 29.4 kilonewtons for maneuvering and deorbiting. The technologies demonstrated in the vehicle include an improved thermal protection system, enhanced avionics, an autonomous guidance system, and an advanced airframe. The Space Force is thought to be in possession of 2 X-37B vehicles, both built by Boeing. The spaceplanes are used primarily as orbital testbeds, allowing the military to see how instruments perform and behave in the space environment. Thursday's mission was the first time the X-37B launched on a Falcon Heavy rocket. It previously launched 5 times on the United Launch Alliance's Atlas V and once on SpaceX's Falcon 9. The aircraft launched on Thursday, dubbed Orbital Test Vehicle 7, carried several scientific experiments from NASA and the U.S. military. "We don't know many details about the mission, the flight plans, the target orbit, and the main payloads, as they were classified. Based on navigational warnings and the fact that it was launched on a Falcon Heavy rocket, it can be estimated that the plane was headed to a highly elliptical, high-inclination orbit, at a much higher altitude than previous missions. The X-37B is highly maneuverable and can change its orbit rapidly, making it difficult to track. Despite being launched like a satellite, the spaceplane will return to Earth at the end of the mission and touch down on runways at either Vandenberg Space Force Base or Kennedy Space Center. It's unclear how long the latest mission will last, but it's safe to assume the spaceplane will be in orbit for some time. All the previous 6 X-37B missions lasted more than 7 months. The sixth mission, launched in May 2020, landed in November 2022, after spending 908 days, or almost 3 years, in orbit. A SpaceX Falcon 9 first stage booster toppled over and broke in half on its way to land, following a successful touchdown on its drone ship. On December 23, SpaceX launched the Starlink Group 6 to 32 mission from Cape Canaveral Space Force Station, aboard a Falcon 9 rocket. The launch vehicle was carrying 23 Starlink V2 mini satellites into low Earth orbit. About 2.5 minutes into the flight, the rocket's first stage separated from the upper stage and began its trip back to Earth. Meanwhile, the second stage continued its flight and eventually deployed the satellites into the intended orbit. After re-entering the Earth's atmosphere, the Falcon 9 first stage, dubbed Booster B1058, landed on the drone ship, just read the instructions, stationed in the Atlantic Ocean, completing its record-setting 19th flight. Later, in a statement on X, SpaceX revealed that the booster tipped over on the drone ship due to high winds and waves during its transportation back to Port Canaveral, Florida. Photos of the returning ship shared online revealed that only the lower section of the booster remained. The top oxygen tank section was lost in the ocean, and some of the engine nozzles were damaged. The landing legs of the booster also incurred damage. Wires were pulled out and strewn over the edge of the drone ship, dragging in the water as the ship returned to its port. According to SpaceX, the booster was tipped over because it was an older rocket and could not receive upgraded landing legs that self-leveled upon landing. The company said that newer Falcon boosters feature improved landing legs with the capability to self-level and mitigate this type of issue. While B1058 will never fly again, SpaceX fully intends to preserve what's left. According to John Edwards, SpaceX's vice president of Falcon launch vehicles, the company plans to salvage the engines and do life leader inspections on the remaining hardware. In addition to completing 19 flights and being the flight leader in SpaceX's Falcon fleet, B1058 made history by being the first vehicle to launch astronauts from American soil since the space shuttle program ended in 2011. In 2020, the first trip of the booster, dubbed Crew Dragon Demo 2, carried Doug Hurley and Bob Behnken, two former NASA astronauts, to the International Space Station. The other 18 flights of the booster that followed the Demo 2 mission included SpaceX's 21st Commercial Resupply Services mission to the ISS, the first and third of transporter rideshare missions, as well as 14 Starlink launches. During its career, which spanned over 3 years, Booster B1058 has launched 2 astronauts and more than 860 satellites, totaling more than 260 metric tons, into low Earth orbit. China successfully launched 2 experimental satellites into space, however, rocket boosters crashed into inhabited areas after the mission. A Long March 3B rocket lifted off from the Zhichang Satellite Launch Center on Tuesday, December 26, carrying 2 Beidou satellites into orbit. Those medium Earth orbit satellites serve as backups for China's Beidou 3 project. Beidou 3 is the third phase of the Beidou Navigation Satellite System, a satellite-based radio navigation system owned and operated by the China National Space Administration. The system consists of 36 active satellites that can provide positional accuracies of under 10 meters. After entering orbit and completing on-orbit testing, the satellites launched on Thursday will be connected to the Beidou system. Meanwhile, videos that surfaced on social media pages suggest that a pair of the side boosters from the Long March 3B rocket used for the launch fell to the ground near inhabited areas in the Guangxi region. In one video, a booster is shown falling into a forest and blowing up, and in another, the booster is seen falling, and then there is wreckage next to a house. The first stage and four side boosters of the Long March 3B use the hypergolic propellant combination of hydrazine and nitrogen tetroxide, which pose serious health risks. Three of China's four major space launch bases are located in sparsely populated areas. This results in rocket boosters falling into inhabited areas rather than the oceans, as with US and European launches. Thank you for tuning in for the latest science news and Starship updates. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button, leave a comment, and share it with your friends. Also, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so you never miss an episode.